Tonight's tinkering is accompanied by white chocolate stout from Spectrum Beer Company in Vancouver, BC. This does not look like what I was expecting when I was promised a stout. That's not bad. It's not as light as it looks. So tonight, I am just tinkering with these LEDs here. They look like standard 5mm LEDs, just have twice as many pins as you'd expect. Normally, when you see a 4-pin 5mm LED, you expect it to be an RGB LED. And yeah, it is. You can see that that's what's going on back here. But these are not just your normal RGB LEDs. These are a serial controllable addressable LED, which you can kind of guess by the fact that these ones back here are acting independently. And there's only one control wire controlling them, just jumping between them. They're not neopixels, though. They're not WS2812s. They are, in fact, PL9823. What makes them different than 2812s, you might ask? There's a couple of things that I've found in my tinkering and research. They have a faster internal clock rate, which has nothing to do with the communication along here. That has to do with the PWM frequencies. Although I think you can see them kind of PWMing here. I was hoping that those would be compatible with the camera, but clearly they're not. Oh well, to the naked eye you can't see that. These things are set at about half brightness right now, which is why you can see the PWM flickering. There, that's more like it. Now they're running, they were running at about 150 out of 255 for brightness on each of the three colors. Now they're running at full brightness, and I'm not seeing any flickeriness. But I guess that makes sense too, since there's no PWM happening. Anyway, controlling these things is just as easy as controlling the standard neopixels or 2812s. The same libraries that we'd use, neopixel works for them, and fast LED works for them. So, and right now, this is, I think, yeah, this is the neopixel library, just the standard Adafruit library. And, well, let me show you. So here's one of the demo sketches that comes with the Adafruit neopixel library. I've just customized it for my application. I've changed the pin number, I've changed the number of pixels. I've changed this frequency to 400 kilohertz instead of 800 based on something that I found in one tutorial online. And I've changed the order of the colors. The WS2812 uses green, red, blue as its sequence. These use red, green, blue, so just changed that. Other than that, it's pretty much the way you find it as a default example. So down in the loop, it's pretty straightforward. Setting the pixel color to green, and then pixels.show, which sends that to the strip, or to the LEDs. Then a delay happens, then I change it to blue, pixels.show, delay, and then change it to green, pixels.show, and then delay. And then the loop loops around, as loops tend to do. Or you can do the same thing using the fast LED library. This is just a demo sketch that comes with the library. I've set the count of LEDs that I'm using. The fast LED library has definitions for all different kinds of addressable LEDs. Some use a clock pin and a data pin, some only use a data pin. These particular ones only use a data pin, so I've only set that, and I've set it to data pin 2, which is what I'm using. And then down in the lengthy list of LED types, I've uncommented the type that I'm using, the PL9823. And then down here is the loop, which is doing essentially the same thing as the other demo sketch that I showed you. Set the LED to green, wait a little bit. Set it to blue, wait a little bit. Set it to red, wait a little bit. And then pop through the loop again to the next LED. One thing fast LED allows you to do is identify colors by names that are defined in the library. Or if you don't want to use those, you can just use standard RGB numbers if you prefer. So that's all well and good, and for anybody who's been playing with addressable LEDs for a while, it's pretty much identical to any other addressable LED. The reason that I got these ones, I think, now that I think about it, is because at the time I bought them, they were the only addressable LEDs that I could find in just a standard 5mm package, which allows you to mount them, you know, anywhere that you'd use a standard LED, which is, I thought, kind of cool. And that allows you to do things like this with the normal WS2812s that come in a 50-50 package. Yeah, you can do, you know, circuit sculpture and whatnot, but I just like the traditional shape. So what I've done here is I've just tied, you know, all the positives together, all the negatives together, and then tied the data ins and outs together all the way around the circle. So that should work just the same as the other thing. Unplug that and plug this into data 2. There we go. Again, that's nothing too earth-shattering, but it was a fun thing to put together. Just zoning out and soldering up this this little guy, trying to keep it into a nice, perfect circle. That's the challenge of this. But what can I use this for? Well, I mean, it's just decorative. What, like any of these things, what else would you use it for? But I figured this is a little awkward running it off there. So I next started experimenting and tinkering with shrinkifying that a little bit. And to do that, I figured I'd use the smallest microcontrollers that I have, which are these ATtiny85 based, what are these things called? DigiSparks. The limitations are, of course, there's only 6 GPIO, but that's okay. We only need one for this project. And here is that connection. I mean, it's again, nothing startling, but it's just a progression in my tinkerage. So I have that same thing hooked up there, and I have literally the same sketch, the same fast LED sketch loaded into here with no changes at all. One thing with the DigiSpark bootloader, it takes a few seconds before it starts running the program because that's how it loads its thing. But you can see that's the same code that I had running on this guy back here. I think that's the same code that's running back there now, actually. Yeah, it's still targeting 8 LEDs, so you get a gap in it. So then I started digging around and trying to see if I had any just a loose ATtiny85 so that I could just bodge it directly into there. But unfortunately, I don't. I will in a few months. I've ordered some. They'll show up in a mailbag. In the meantime, I think I'm just going to solder one of these guys into the middle of there and call it good, just to have a standalone project for now. I mean, it's, again, not much of a project, but it is a project. And again, this wasn't ever intended to be some earth-shattering revelation. I was just tinkering with some random LEDs that I found in my stash that I'd ordered years ago. So I wonder if I've got a little bit smaller one in here. Is that smaller? It is. Okay. So until I get some standalone 85s in the mail, I think I'll just solder that guy into the middle of there and call it done for now. That data pin should hold it fairly rigidly in there. Get the ground pin in here. That ought to do it. And as a finishing touch, I'll just tag a USB cable onto here for a power lead, just for the fun of it. Probably other ways I could do it, but for now, that'll do. This is not a permanent solution. This is just, as I said, a first attempt. So let's see how it looks. Oh yeah, and I changed the sketch that this thing's running to. So it's very, very similar to the one that's back there. It's got 8 LEDs defined. I'm using the numeric values for RGB rather than the color names, and I've just got the random number generator picking a random red, green, and blue each time it goes through the loop. So each time it writes another LED, it's going to be a slightly different random color. I'm just going to keep doing that. I thought that was kind of a cool thing. And I mean, the sky's the limit really, because it's just software, but I don't know. I had fun with this. I explored a part that I hadn't played with before, and I got to play with a little bit of this circuit sculpture kind of stuff. So all in all, I think tonight's a win, and even the beer's okay. Thanks for watching. Questions, comments down below as usual. I'll talk to you later.